The Charles W. Morgan was built in 1841 in New Bedford, Massachusetts. She sailed the world during the golden age of whaling. When her whaling days ended in 1921, the Morgan had completed 37 voyages and made millions of dollars for her owners. But the Morgan was much more than a whale ship. The Morgan was designed and built by Jethro and Zachariah Hillman, one of the many ships built by the brothers.
Now, the Hillman brothers were the sons of Zachariah Hillman I. The shipyard was formed by Zachariah I. He lived on the corner of North 2nd and Hillman Street in the northwest corner. The shipyard was at the bottom of the hill on Maxfield Street, and of course you may wonder, how could the shipyard be there since there's so much land at the bottom of the hill? Well, there wasn't. That's all filled land where the North Terminal is and the railroad yard is, and the shipyard is sitting, was sitting basically under where some of this fill was. And it was a typical shipyard of the 19th century. It had the boat ways to bring the boats up and assemble them and construct them and then float them out. It had sheds for drying lumber because you couldn't use green lumber. You had to let it dry out. Up at the house, Zachariah's house, he also had some sheds for storage and carpenter sheds and other things because everything was relatively close together. But they built wonderful ships, very, very sturdy, and they lasted for years. And the Morgan is a testament to that.
The Charles W. Morgan measured 105 feet 6 inches in length with a 27 foot 6 inch beam in a depth of 17 feet 6 inches. She carried 13,000 square feet of sail and weighed 351 tons. She cost $52,000 to make and returned from her first voyage with a cargo valued at $56,000.
It was owned by Charles W. Morgan, but surprisingly, he wasn't the only owner. The Hillman brothers also had ownership interest in the ship, as they did for a number of their ships. What better to make sure the ship was seaworthy and very well done than if you didn't own part of it, to make sure you got your return on your investment from other directions? They were very smart businessmen, these people. They knew what they were doing, so the ship was actually owned by Morgan and the brothers, although nobody really talks much about that.
The launch of the Charles W. Morgan was announced in the 1841 New Bedford Mercury with this brief paragraph. A fine ship of 350 tons burthen, intended for the whale fishery, will be launched from the yard of Messrs. J. and Z. Hillman this morning at 9:30. The Morgan sailed around the world multiple times between 1841 and 1921. Her 37 voyages included several different captains and crew members from around the world. During her time as a whale ship, the Charles W. Morgan brought home over 54,000 barrels of whale oil and 153,000 pounds of whale bone. Despite the hazards of whaling voyages and cramped quarters, many crew members sailed multiple voyages.
My grandfather was John Theophilus Gonsalves, and he was a whaling captain, and he had been on various ships. And then with all the research we had done about my grandfather, we found out that he was on 30 different ships. And out of the 30, he was captain of 12 whaling ships. And plus the 30, he was captain on 3 packet ships going back and forth to Cape Verde. So, well, my grandfather was born on December 16, 1858 in Brava, Cape Verde Islands. He was 11 years old when he got on the first whaling ship as a cabin boy. From the 11 years old, then he worked himself up to being cook and all various jobs. And then he became first mate and second mate. Eventually, at the age of 21 or 22, he became a captain of his first ship.
John T. Gonsalves would serve as captain on several whaling ships before joining the Morgan.
Captain Edwards was the captain of the Morgan of that particular voyage number 37, but he was sick, and the Morgan came in, and Captain Edwards had to go to the hospital. So my grandfather was asked to become the captain of the Morgan, so he took the Morgan out on voyage number 37, and the Morgan left in September 1920, and they were out until May of 1921. And he had a full Cape Verdean crew on that particular voyage. And doing that, they came back in 9 months, and they captured 2,702 barrels of oil that they had on that particular trip. So that's how he became the captain of the Morgan. So,
despite a voyage filled with challenges, the Morgan, under the leadership of Captain Gonsalves, had a profitable journey. However, when she sailed into New Bedford Harbor on May 28, 1921, her future was uncertain. With the decline of whaling, the Morgan was able to pay the bills as a semi-charter in the silent film Miss Petticoats. Some of the scenes took place on a whaling ship. The only alteration was the new name, Harpoon, nailed over the Morgan name. The film was shot over the summer of 1916 and was completed in September of the same year. The Morgan's second movie appearance, and perhaps her most well-known, was in the silent film Down to the Sea in Ships. While the actual sailing scenes were of the bark Wanderer, the scenes at port were of the Morgan. The film also included one of the ship's former first mates, Theophilo M. Freitas, as a harpooner. Filmed in 1922, after the Morgan's final whaling voyage, Down to the Sea in Ships featured, among others, Clara Bow, who later became famous as the It Girl. The film's world premiere was held at the Olympia Theater in New Bedford on September 25, 1922. The Morgan's third and final film was Javahead, in which she played the part of an East Indian merchant ship. The movie was filmed in 1923 in Salem, Massachusetts. The Morgan's short-lived movie career ended after three movies, leaving her future once again in limbo. Financial backing was difficult to obtain, despite the efforts of artist Harry Nyland.
The ship's destiny was almost decided by unforeseen circumstances in 1924. After spending 3 years at a pier in New Bedford Harbor, the ship was almost completely destroyed by fire.
By good fortune, it escaped being burned when the steamer Sankaty burned in New Bedford and floated across the harbor and bumped into it. Because of the tugboat and a number of firefighters, the Morgan was saved and towed out away from the Sankaty.
Harry Nyland once again worked to obtain funding to repair the Morgan, this time hoping New Bedford legislators would help declare the ship a national shrine. But things had changed in New Bedford. The growing textile industry had replaced whaling as the city's number one commercial enterprise. Many of the businesses supporting whaling closed as the schooner John R. Mantra left in 1925 on what would be the final whaling voyage. Nyland enlisted the aid of colleagues interested in saving the ship. 32 others joined in his efforts, each purchasing a 1/32nd share in the Morgan.
I had a talk with myself one night and realized how instrumental my grandfather, my great-great-grandfather, and my great-great-uncle had been in the initial preservation in 1925. They were all involved in the incorporation called Whaling Enshrined, which basically salvaged the Morgan, which I believe was sitting very derelict at a dock in Fairhaven. And they said, you know, maybe we ought to try to save this ship. It's the last ship. I believe the Wanderer had been wrecked the summer before in a gale off of Cutty Hunk. So they incorporated. They talked to Colonel Green, who was all in favor of having the Morgan go to Colonel Green's. And he would underwrite the cost of it, and he did an amazing job. He built a dock, he, you know, put in old buildings. It was a great tourist attraction.
The organization Whaling Enshrined, Inc. was intended to be a permanent group whose purpose was to enshrine and preserve the Morgan and other relics of the whaling industry.
Well, my grandfather John Morgan Bullard. He was the attorney who set up the papers. Originally, it was this gentleman named Harry Nyland, who was the lead guy, and you've probably heard of him, who had the majority interest in it. But I think my grandfather, my great-grandfather, William Wallace Crapo, who gave the Whaleman statue to the city of New Bedford 100 years ago, and my great-uncle Henry, who wrote several family histories, they each had a 1/32nd share in the Morgan while it was in Whaling enshrined.
On July 21st, 1926, the trustees of Whaling enshrined and donors of the whale ship Charles W. Morgan held a dedication ceremony. A plaque dedicating the ship's enshrinement was placed beside the Morgan. It listed all 33 owners and ended with Colonel Edward Howland Robinson Green. Colonel Edward Howland Robinson Green was born on August 22, 1868. His title was bestowed on him by Texas Governor O.B. Colquitt, who appointed Green a lieutenant colonel on his military staff in 1910. He was the only son of Henrietta Hetty Howland Robinson Green and Edward Henry Green. Hetty was known as the Witch of Wall Street and was at one time the richest woman in America. After her death in 1916, Colonel Green and his sister inherited a significant amount of money. In 1917, following his marriage to longtime love Mabel E. Harlow, he began construction of a summer cottage on Round Hill in Dartmouth, Massachusetts.
That property goes back in the Howlands, goes way, way, way back to 17 something. And so his mother had left him her share of that property. It was over 200 acres. And he went, after she died, he went down there one day to look at the property and decided that God wasn't making any more waterfront. So he was gonna do something with this. Half of it belonged to another Howland relative. He bought that half so that he had that whole piece that projected out into Buzzards Bay. And then he, in 1921, he built the little summer cottage down there, the mansion, right?
The restoration and preservation of the Morgan was of particular interest for Colonel Green.
Well, the Morgan goes back to his family. His mother's relatives owned the whaling, you know, that big whaling business. And I think it was his grandfather who had owned the Morgan at one time. And he just didn't want to see it just, you know, go to pieces. And it was a historical thing. So he bought it and they brought it down to Round Hill. They removed all the rocks and everything. They pulled the Morgan in there, and it was in sand. And as I said, there is a, if you look in the book, you'll find the blueprint, shall we say, for that. And then, of course, he had it redone. They had flags done. He tried to make a little village, a little whaling village right around the Morgan there. He had a little museum, and he had a blacksmith shop, and that blacksmith shop started out in New Bedford, and he bought it when the fellow who owned it died. The colonel bought it and brought it down to Round Hill. May 7, 1925, after 9 months of restoration work, it was open to the public, so that's 1925. Thousands of people would come down and visit, and he had these commemorative coins. I have one I can show you that he would give away to the people that came to go on the Morgan, and they would all, yeah, people loved it. Thousands of people. I mean, you had at some weekends where there was 20,000 people coming down, people would come down and they'd go for a swim and they'd go on the Morgan. And what they did was, I love this part, they would put stuff on the windows of the car. They would spray stuff on the car, some kind of soap, so they could change into their bathing suits in the car without being seen. So, but I mean, it's a wonderful thing for a family to do.
Colonel Green died in 1936. There was no provision in his will for the care of the Morgan.
You know, they all thought, oh, this is great. You know, Colonel Green has provided for her in his will. And that was not the case. And so the poor Morgan, after Colonel Green's death, my grandfather and I believe Harry Nyland and some of those folks, Mayor Ashley was involved, really went to people and tried to get money to keep it going, but it was a losing cause. Then the hurricane of 1938 came by and just really did so much damage. And at that point, you know, it's the beginnings, the dawn of World War II, and Mystic, thank goodness, came and stepped in and said, well, you know, we'd like to give her a home. And when you think about, if they had waited a year or two, it wouldn't have happened, because World War II would have come and people's focus would be someplace else.
So my dad hadn't seen and when he first took one look at the Morgan after the 38 hurricane in the preparation to bring her to Fairhaven, he was devastated with the condition it was in. However, they hired a bunch of caulkers. Caulkers are people that it's a special trade, and they have this material that's made out of a natural material that's wound around something on the idea of a small rope. And it comes in a strand, and it's placed inside the seam of a vessel where two pieces of wood meet, becomes a seam. And it is stuffed, the caulking oakum is stuffed into the seam, and then there's a tool, like a caulking iron, that looks similar to a putty knife, but it's much thicker and much heavier. And you hit that caulking iron with a mallet, a wooden mallet, and you push it in as far as it'll go to keep the water out and keep the... Well, there were some that were so bad, they not only needed caulking, they needed a piece of pine board nailed on to keep the caulking in. And it was a big job. It was a dirty job, but my father was happy doing it. First of all, because he had work, and second of all, because it was on a wooden vessel. That was his thing. And he would continue to haul out on the Morgan, trying to pull it out of this, and they'd dig a little more and dig a little more. Finally, on the 1st of November, the General Green showed up. That was the Coast Guard cutter that towed the Morgan down to Mystic in November. And so on November 1st, the General Green put a tow line on the Morgan as well as the Vindex, and they did manage to get it out of there. And they put a line aboard it and towed it to Union Wharf in Fairhaven, where my father continued to work on it, getting it ready to go to Mystic. The Morgan finally sailed the 5th of November and went down to Mystic at that time. The skipper was a Mr. Bill Tripp, that was the curator at the Whaling Museum at the time. He was listed as the last skipper of the Charles W. Morgan. The first mate was a man by the name of Young. He also was from the Whaling Museum, neither one of which had any sailing experience. Listed as second mate was Captain Claude S. Tucker, and he was really the man that was taking things by the by the horn and getting things done.
Her departure generated a full page of pictures in the Standard Times. Included was a photograph of a banner touting Mystic as the proud home of the Charles W. Morgan.
When it got going through the railroad bridge and the vehicle bridge down in Mystic, there were crowds of people. There were loads and loads of people just lining every street that was going up to Greenmanville there. There were all kinds of people lining every dock and every street going up to have a look at it. It was quite a happening for them.
In 1944, a short article appeared on the front page of the Standard Times. The Morgan was included in a list of other items from the Green Estate acquired by the association. Following much-needed renovations, the Morgan once again became a tourist attraction. Several of the buildings that had surrounded her on Round Hill were transferred to Mystic Seaport as well, creating a replica of her whaling port.
Thank God that she survived as long as she did in New Bedford. If New Bedford hadn't done what it did, she would not be still here. Colonel Green hadn't done what he did, she would not be here. There would be no ship left to tell the story. She was designated a National Historic Landmark in 1966. Because not only is she the last wooden whale ship in the world, she's also the oldest American commercial vessel.
It actually took only 7 months with a crew of 31 people to build this vessel from scratch, which we're now restoring over a period of 5 years.
I think when the Morgan came to Mystic, it not only gave life to Mystic Seaport as an entity, but I think it became the sort of the focal point of the development of a large component of our tourist industry. The ship itself was really the only and the major historic attraction that helped build the entire cultural heritage theme here in southeastern Connecticut. All ships need constant maintenance and attention, no matter what material they're made out of. It's especially true of wooden ships. And wooden ships also have the advantage, though, over others of being able to be continuously renewed. You'll notice that there's many different shores and jack stands and poppets holding the vessel up, and that's important for a number of reasons. First of all, the vessel over time has gotten weak, so we need to support it in its shape and form, but we also need to be able to manipulate that shape and bring it back to more of what it was when it was originally a whaling ship back in the 19th century. Over time, wooden ships tend to deteriorate and they change shape, hogging, and they lose shear, that is sort of bending downward in the ends. And part of this restoration effort has been to remediate some of that hog and bring her back closer to the form that she was.
These ships had multiple functions. They had to sail, they had to carry the cargo, and they also were working ships, so where they actually tried out the blubber or rendered the oil. And this is where that happened, in these tripods. This feature, which seems so simple to us, to have the furnaces, if you will, on the ship, are what freed up the ship so that they were able to leave land and go to all the oceans of the world. That's how whaling expanded. It was because they could capture the whales, take the blubber off, cut it up, and basically render or melt it in these pots, turn it into oil. So think about it. What you actually have is a wooden ship at sea loaded with oil, which has a giant fire on it as they render the oil. Right where we are, there would have been chimneys that went up. But it was in these tripods. And interestingly enough, once they finally were full, and remember that the ship was full, sometimes again that was 3 to 4 years of a voyage, one of the things they would do is they would take the triworks apart. They would save the kettles, but the bricks would be thrown overboard. And that was a big moment for the crew because it meant they were going home.
The fueling of the triworks is a very popular question with visitors. And The fact is that they brought enough wood to start the first whale. Now remember, they were going to try out about 40 to 60 whales on a typical voyage, so that would have been a huge volume of wood or coal. So what they did was to fire the triworks with wood as they started rendering the first whale. Anytime that you render fat from any kind of an animal, you wind up with cracklings or things like pork rinds, which are basically fibrous tissue, pieces of skin, etc., that still have oil and therefore BTU content within them. So once they started to get cracklings, they fed those back into the fire, and they would then save cracklings from the whale that they were processing now to do the next whale. So it became a self-perpetuating process as far as the energy to do the processing of the oil was concerned.
When she was fully manned and underway in the height of the whaling era, she carried about 34 hands, including captain and officers. Now that's considerably more than would have been carried on a merchant ship of the same size because of the special activity of whaling and all of the support trades, coopers, carpenters capable of rebuilding whaleboats and things like that that other ships wouldn't necessarily carry.
This is a very unique type of steering gear, which may be a specialty for whale ships. It's called the shin cracker. It basically provides the mechanical advantage of a wheel with a very simple and elegant engineering solution. The wheel actually travels with the tiller as the rudder turns. Therefore, it's called the shin cracker. That's its nickname, because in the event that the ship gets out of control and broaches, the wheel and the tiller are going to come sweeping across right about at shin level and crack you right in the legs. So it's a really elegant device from an engineering point of view, simple and easy to maintain, and I think, again, unique to whaling vessels.
Okay, the structure that we see in front of us is very stoutly built, but you see it's got a lot of glass. It actually, part of it is taken ashore to be repaired during the restoration. There's a peaked dome here, and it's essentially a large skylight to provide light to the officers' quarters down below. The officers' dining table is directly below it. In that skylight would have been contained the compass as well. Then throughout the rest of the ship, there are small deck prisms that are inlaid into the deck planking. And what they do is they absorb a little bit of light on deck and spread it out down below. And that's about the only natural light that you had below decks on the vessel. Kerosene lamps in the officers' quarters, maybe a candle or a rudimentary lamp in the forecastle. Okay, we're back aft all the way by the helm. And the structure that protects the helm is referred to as a hurricane house for sort of obvious reasons, that in real extreme weather, it gives you a little bit of protection while you're still steering the ship, which must go on no matter what the weather. But it's also the companionway to get down to the captain's cabin and officers' quarters. On the other side there, on the starboard side, is the galley. There's the cook stove in there. And then back aft is just bosun's stores. And on this side is another officer's head. Now that would be the galley that would feed all of the ship's complement. But the food that would feed the officers and would differ from that which would be fed to the common hands. So the officers had their own pantry down below.
This is the captain's stateroom. It features a gimbaled bed, which means that this bed actually compensates for the side-to-side swing of the ship and stays level as the ship rolls. And then aft is a set of stairs which is going up to the captain's private head. This is the day cabin of the captain's suite, along with a red velvet covered settee. This is where he could there's a desk here where he could make notes and do logs in the daytime, possibly entertain other captains when they met another ship at sea. This is where the captain and the mates and other invited guests, including possibly the captain's wife, if she happened to be aboard, would eat their meals. The hole in the center of the table now has a ventilation pipe in it during the restoration, but that's actually where the mizzen mast would have come down through the deck to step to the keel. This is the first mate's cabin. He was the only person other than the captain to have private quarters. It includes his bunk, some storage area underneath, and a small desk where he can fulfill his duty of completing the daily ship's log. This is the second and third mate's cabin, so there are two men in this one. As you now move down in the hierarchy, you get less and less privacy. So two bunks and storage space. This is the boat steerer's, or harpooner's, bunk room. Boat steerer's was the whaling term for the harpooners. And as you can see by the number of bunks, there might have been as many as six Queequegs living here, along with their personal belongings. Down in the hold of the Charles W. Morgan, where the major part of the restoration work is being conducted at the moment. And this consists primarily of replacing futtocks, which are components of the frames or the ribs that hold the ship together. As we look around the room here, we see that most of the frames are rather dark colored. That's original wood from 1841. So that was originally installed when the ship was built. As we look at lighter pieces of wood in the sides, those are futtocks that are being replaced. For the most part, the material for those components are live oak, which we acquired in the south after Katrina and other major storms. So the technique is that we make patterns from the old futtocks. They actually walk around the yard looking for pieces of live oak that has grain that matches the contour from that pattern, choose the oak, and then cut it to fit. The numbers that you see at the tops of frames are actually reference points. They number from the bow to the stern, each frame on each side. So right now we're looking at the port side of the vessel, and we're looking at P50, P51, P52, and there are corresponding numbers on the starboard side of the vessel. These are used for documenting the condition of the ship itself and for talking about and describing the work that's being done. And in fact, if you were to look at new replacement futtocks already milled down on the lot, you'd see that they were marked something like 42 number one or 46 number two. That's where they're going to go into the structure as replacements when the time comes. And then as we look aft down there, we're looking into the stern section, and you can see down there that the structure is much more complex because this is where the hull is changing shape. The rudder is attached back here, so this is the internal structure of the after part. This is called a trunnel. It's actually a slightly tapered dowel with a flat end on it. And the technique for using this is if you have two things that you want to fasten together, like for instance a plank on the outside of the ship to a rib on the inside of the ship, you actually drill through both pieces with a slightly undersized hole. You use a mallet or a sledgehammer to pound this in, and then as it protrudes, you cut a slot into the end of it, and you pound in a wedge, which makes it expand. And then you saw it off even with the external and the internal surfaces of the vessel, and so it tightens rather than loosens as it gets wet, and it provides a really strong, very tight fastening, which, as we now know, lasts for, in this case, for well over 150 years.
Now, there are two important reasons why we want to sail the vessel. Number one, of course, that there's these historic links between the ship and New Bedford and other ports in southern New England, because that's where she was built and that's where she operated from and that's where her economic impact was felt the most. But essentially, Mystic Seaport is today the caretaker of the vessel. We don't feel we own the ship per se, but we're simply the caretakers for the moment. The ship is a National Historic Landmark. It's significant to American history and to all Americans. And by sailing the vessel, we'll be demonstrating how we share that common ownership. In 1941, when the ship came here, I don't think anybody could have envisioned the impact that the vessel would have had. Certainly, we knew that it would attract people to the institution, Mystic Seaport, but I don't think anyone envisioned that this entire region would develop a maritime identity and heritage that it has.
On July 21st, 2013, the Charles W. Morgan was launched into the waters of the Mystic River. Renovations complete, the ship was carefully lowered into the water during a public ceremony to float on her own for the first time since 2008. The ship was christened by Sally Bullard, the great-great-great-granddaughter of Charles W. Morgan, the man for whom the ship is named. The bottle Bullard broke across the bow was filled with waters from the oceans over which the ship sailed during her 80-year whaling career.
And that was an experience. They had us aboard the steamboat Sabina, and there was the Morgan on hauled out and a dock, and then the Sabina. And we were on the starboard side of the Sabina, looking right at the Morgan, high up on the second deck, seeing her before, just after she had been hauled out, and then seeing her again after she had been rebuilt. I was amazed. But I did take my son, and I took my grandson with us. So we had the three generations of the descendants of the last caretaker of the Morgan. So it was quite an honor to have the three of us there. I'm sure my dad would be very proud. Yeah.
I'm quite sure that the Morgan means a tremendous amount, both emotionally and historically, to the population in New Bedford. I know that in past years there's sometimes been a little bit of unhappiness expressed that the ship came here. But put in the cultural and historic context of the time, in fact, had she not come here to this very sheltered, protected harbor with a maritime preservation entity that was already in existence and had the wherewithal to care for the ship, that she probably would have been lost like many of her sisters. So while it's unfortunately a loss for that region, it's been a positive gain for the country as a whole. And hopefully we can pay that back a little bit by our visit in a couple of years when the restoration is complete.
So when you think about it, it's just, she's been a lucky ship from the day she was launched. She really has, as you know. And how lucky she is now, when you see her now, and to see how beautiful she looks, and to think that she's going to come sailing back into New Bedford. Matthew Stackpole, in one of our conversations, said that he had been having a conversation with his daughter on the telephone, and he was talking about how magnificent it would be when the Morgan comes sailing into New Bedford, and his daughter said to him, "And there will be the ghost ships of all of the whaling ships that didn't make it come in behind her." And that vision has just stuck in my head. Isn't that amazing?